So this is a overview session as well as clarification session. What I would like to hear from you is about the lab yesterday. Is there something you would like to convey in terms of the exercise or because as I said, it's difficult. People have come from different backgrounds. Some know TCP dump upfront, some don't know at all. The way the lab is designed, whatever it is. So if there is some feedback which you can convey, so that, again, I always emphasize feedback is very important, because whatever feedback you provide, I can refine the lab such that later when the main workshop is going to be organized, it's easier for them to get on with the lab. So it should be with that in mind. If there is something, I know that maybe I felt at the end that I should have provided an overview of each lab, which I will do now on, but any feedback?
Again, it's like the typical classroom of 250 people, 10% are highly motivated, maximum 70%, they were like just trying to do something. And so experiment number 1, 2, 3, maximum of us could attempt. But fourth, very few attempted actually. And we couldn't get the time to attempt fourth one. That is what is my observation is.
Okay. So as I said, I mean, when I designed it itself, I had put it slightly, like someone who knows it can definitely finish it before time. Someone who is starting to learn stuff, maybe it's on the bit on the higher side. In fact, this exercise is lesser than what I normally give as part of, but that's because a lot of our students are familiar with a lot of the systems, like Linux, they're familiar, scripting, they've already have done some experience with TCP dump Wireshark. So for them, it's easier. That said, yes, it's when you are catering, you always tend to add extra so that whoever has the time will do the extra, whoever is, some learning has to happen. That's the final goal. In terms of the difficulty level, did people find it very difficult or it's all right?
And there is a Windows operating system in our university, so there was no Unix or Linux practice in our university. So that's why there was a problem, like you have given commands in Unix and Linux, so I was not familiar with that.
Okay.
So again, the students or participants which are coming, so they will also face problem because they wish or they would want that so there should be some Windows implementation of these command or practice on the networking, because Windows is more popular and the thing which they handle in their colleges more. So some networking assignment or networking lab assignment on Windows should be there.
Okay. So in that context, let me ask you a question. How many of you are have people, I know majority of you are Windows user. The Cygwin people use on Windows extensively, like you yourself? Cygwin, you know the installation of Cygwin and stuff. You have done it before? No.
No.
Okay. So, well, anyway, I mean, if Linux system, I thought the installation is kind of straightforward and it comes with it. In Windows, installation of many of this, like NS2 and all, I wouldn't say it is difficult, but it is a little bit more involved than Linux installation. I thought it will make your life easy in installing the packages on Linux rather than on Windows. But that said, let me look into see if... See, even in Windows, when you're using NS2, the terminal that you open will be, again, a Linux kind of a terminal. It'll be a Cygwin terminal, where, again, you have to use the CD, whatever. So because the tools are like that, you cannot get away with not having, because these are developed from academia, they have come. And Linux is open source, so they tend to custom fit most of them for that. But that said, point is well taken. Let me look into it to see if something can be done on the Windows system as well. Yes.
Questions are very good, and it's very good for to give in the puzzle for the mind. And but one thing that I think it should be in Bodhi tree, there must be a link for submission the assignment, and there must be some grading scheme before open the solution to other. It may be open in next day or further, but if it has been evaluated, then it can be a better approach.
I agree totally. Let me make a few other points in that context. So this lab exercise, we had two versions. There was one version which you have not seen. The original version was a very spoon feeding, which I call as a spoon feeding kind of an exercise, where you tell, open the terminal, type CD, you run this command, open Wireshark, go through the trace, click on the first packet, look at this field, what does it do? Or some such kind of a very spoon feeding type of version of the lab one is also there. But then I felt, so when you have a spoon feeding thing, it makes life very easy, definitely. You just have to follow the instructions, do it and do. What I've seen with my own students, like who have done this lab, is they do it, tuck, 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 they finish much faster. And then later we have, what is it called, an evaluation of the lab, where we test what is it that they understood as part of the lab. And many of them just don't seem to understand why did they do the lab in the first place. I mean, what is the goal of the lab? What is the objective of the lab? Then we scratched all this spoon feeding type of lab exercises and it went on into this mode where you ask the students themselves to design the experiment. That is when they appreciate what is it that they have done, they tend to appreciate, because this was the goal, I designed the experiment and that is what I am actually expected to watch. So some of these labs have been designed with that goal in mind. But when it comes to designing lab experiments on your own, time is a premium. In other words, if you, especially for someone who don't have any background and ask them to start designing an experiment, the same lab, if I had given you, let's say 7 hours or 6 hours, I'm sure you'll do an outstanding job of completing the assignment and so on. But again, everything is packed. So if I give 3 hours, maybe things are not as confusing and whatever, but I mean, there is a deliberation. If you do it, you will feel happy, but maybe you may not learn much. If I do it in this lab, give a goal and ask you to do it, then it will be a challenging thing. You may not finish the assignment on time, but then you are learning something. The point I wish to emphasize here is whatever happens, this is not the ending point. Your learning has not stopped once the clock hit 5. The idea is you understood what the goal of the experiment is, you know what the method is. Redo it, I mean, take additional time, try to finish the portion, relook at the assignment and go through it once more, understand it well. And then when you're introducing it, because there is a timing constraint at this workshop, for example, when you're redoing it in your own college with your own students, just give one, I mean, this had 4 questions or 3 questions, just give one question in a lab. Let them take how much ever time they want, finish it. And then next day you give another question, whatever it takes for them to do it. So that was the goal in mind when this assignment was given. But that said, I do understand that, I mean, it takes time. It's not a straightforward thing because we are constrained in time. I'm trying to push things. That's one of the reasons. I just want you to understand that's the thought process that went behind.
I'm Manmohan Sharma from FET Modi Institute of Technology. Actually, a few of the software is not installed like Wireshark because it is giving some error. Apart from that, a few of the commands also we are running first time like TCP dump. So we do not have any idea about what we need to analyze out of this one,
okay.
How we need to analyze. So that is the problem we are facing.
Sure. So that is the point noted. So what I will do is this lab on, I'm going to spend a little bit time, like maybe 15 minutes explaining some of the stuff just to get you started. That I will do henceforth. Any other?
Thank you for, extending this help because yesterday we are totally blank and because we're not exposed much to the Linux environment. So that is what my request is, that before going to the lab, if you have an overview of the tools that we're going to use for the lab,
okay.
And the bit stuffing, all those commands or kind of headers, so we can do it better and we can understand the concept more better. That is
okay.
What my request is.
Sure. So anyway, since you have already had the experience, I'll just provide you an overview. But going forward with the main workshop, I will address as to how to tackle it to your remote center, what you're doing. Maybe you will have to provide an overview session. Maybe I'll prepare the slides for the overview session and pass it to you. And maybe you can make their lives easier. Okay. So what we are going to do is, so today's lab is a continuation of demultiplexing. And we will also look into ARP. So these are the two things that we are going to look at. So before I get into the details, let me also tell, which I'm sure you have figured out by now, but let me emphasize, the way many of these lab exercises are to be done is you have to collect a trace. In order to collect a trace, one of the first things you should do is run TCP dump. Now, TCP dump is a very sophisticated tracing tool. If you just run TCP dump, it collects all the packets that it sees, that the host receives. Most of them are broadcast that it is receiving. So it collects a variety. I mean, if you'll see the screen scrolling very fast. So there are a huge number of packets that you are collecting. Naturally, if there are too many packets, it's not easy to evaluate. You want to focus on packets of interest. So for this, TCP dump provides this very nice filters. So you saw some of the filters like host, source and destination, port. You can specify the type of packet, whatever it is. So you have to put a filter. Now, if I were to give away what the filter is, you don't really understand the appreciate the role of TCP dump, but you're free to Google around, search for Google for what filter to use, whatever it is I'm saying, you should put in some effort to figure out what the filter is. So the typical way is open a terminal, then you do TCP dump with some filters. What filter to use will vary from experiment to experiment. You have to figure out what these filters are. So this is happening in a terminal. Then in another terminal, you do some activity. So this activity is again a function of the experiment. For example, in the previous lab, wget was an activity that you got, because using wget, you are trying to download a HTML page from the particular server and you want to capture what are the packets exchanged as part of this wget. SSH is another activity. You may want to open multiple SSH connections. So in today's lab, when you are doing demultiplexing, one of the problems you will see is you will try to open two SSH connections between the same source and the same destination and kind of figure out how does the source and the destination distinguish between these two SSH sessions. So that is the problem statement. And you have to design an experiment for that. So for that, there's a TCP dump, and then activity will involve you opening the SSH sessions. And once you're done with this activity, you terminate your TCP dump, and then you use Wireshark. By the way, when you do this TCP dump, you have to save it in some, the trace file in a, into a file. Typically, minus W is the option you use. So Wireshark, you open the file. And now once you open it, you can go through what are the sequence of packets. And again, as I said, your filters are very important here because you want to focus on the packets of interest. You don't want to look at other packets. So this is the typical setup for many of these experiments that you are going to see, okay? Demultiplexing, the first portion, as I said, is SSH. I think given your practice in the previous lab, this should not create any problems. There are another next, so there are overall three exercises. First one is this SSH placed demultiplexing, and there are two exercises on ARP. People know what ARP does, right? I don't have to explain it, but let me just make one liner. So ARP is a protocol that is used to obtain the MAC address corresponding to a given IP address. So if I for example want to find out, I want to send a packet to a specific destination. Before I send the packet, I have to send it out on the link layer. I need to specify what the destination MAC address is, for which I need to find out what the MAC address corresponding to that specific IP address is. Now, whenever you send a packet, so this exercise, again, there are two exercises within this, as I said. The first exercise is a combination of how forwarding works in conjunction with ARP. So what happens here is there is the concept of hosts within the same subnet, hosts in different subnets and non-existent hosts. In other words, these hosts are not up, it's not a valid IP address. Okay, so these are the three things that are there. Now, hosts within a same subnet means hosts that are in the same lab. They share the same subnet mask. So if you look at, the subnet is 10.105 or star dot star. This is the same across NSL, OSL, NSL, NX. They're all part of the same subnet. Okay, so these are all the hosts that are within the same subnet. Now, when you're sending a packet to a host within the same subnet, the MAC address will correspond to what? The destination directly, because it's within the same subnet. But on the other hand, if you're sending a packet to a host that is outside the subnet, the MAC address will correspond to what? The router, right? So this is what something you should see in practice. So when you do this experiment within the same subnet, you will see that the destination IP MAC combination will be the same as that of your destination. Whereas in the other case, the destination IP will correspond to something that is outside your subnet, whereas the MAC address will correspond to your next hop router. So this is an activity that you're going to do. And when you try to ping a non-existent host, what happens? So again, I will not reveal the surprise, so you figure it out yourself. So what does ARP do? So here is I'm telling ARP, find out the MAC address corresponding to this IP address, but that IP address machine is not up. Now what does ARP do then? So that is also something you're going to figure out. Okay, so that I will leave. The other thing which we are also going to focus, the third exercise, is this gratuitous ARP. I mentioned this again in the videos briefly, so let me tell at a high level what a gratuitous ARP is. So sometimes for certain functionality, like for example detecting duplicate IP addresses or what, for network functionality, you tend to generate a gratuitous ARP. Gratuitous ARP is an ARP which you're generating by yourself to inform others what your IP versus MAC pairing is. In other words, no one asked for it, but you are just telling them that this is my IP address, this is my MAC address. Okay, it has certain functionality. You look up at the slides. I don't want to go into the details. So what we are going to use is we will use a tool called ARP ping. This is the tool that we are going to use to generate a gratuitous ARP. So you should definitely look at the man pages. But just to make things convenient for you, I have given how to use this particular command, ARPing. This ARPing can be used to generate an ARP request as well as an ARP reply. I mean, the packet that you are going to send is an ARP packet. In one, it's the same information it is carrying, which is this is my IP address, this is my MAC address. But you can send it in the form of an ARP request packet or in the form of an ARP reply packet. So based on this, people are going to make note of the particular information. So what you are going to see here is this ARP request, ARP replies, how do they differ? And how does this gratuitous ARP work? So that is what this is going to test. A point again I want to mention here is I did mention something about ARP spoofing. So what often this gratuitous ARPs does is it is used in the context of ARP spoofing. In other words, what people do is I'm an attacker. So what I will do is, and let's say there is a victim. So the victim's IP address, what I will announce when I do gratuitous ARP is I will announce victim's IP address and give my own attacker's MAC and saying I am the MAC corresponding to the victim's IP address so that all packets for the victim will then come to me. So this is ARP spoofing, which is done based on gratuitous ARP. You are not going to do spoofing. In fact, this ARPing command will not permit you to, it's a user level thing. You cannot set someone's IP address to your MAC and do it. There are, all this ARPing does is you can generate a gratuitous ARP for your own IP address. You cannot generate one for someone else with your MAC. So as part of this exercise, you are going to generate a gratuitous ARP for your own IP address with your own MAC, okay? Though you can potentially do it, but that's a hack. We are not covering that here. So this is more or less what today's lab is about. Hopefully this will get you started and you can evaluate what is happening through the traces. Any questions on this?
Madam, you told that when these two hosts are within the same subnet, then when you get the MAC address of the next hop, you will get the MAC address of the destination. But even when these two hosts are in the same subnet, the packets must be going via switch.
Yes.
So the next hop address should be the MAC address of switch.
Switches are transparent switches.
It doesn't have a MAC address.
They may have a MAC address for what is it called, configuration of the switch. So switches are transparent in that what they do is they get the packet and they have a routing thing and they're just going to send it out on that interface. So more or less it goes to the, if it's a broadcast packet, it will reach everyone. Otherwise it will go through the, you're not targeting, switch is transparent in that you're not targeting the packet to the switch for any evaluation. It will just look at the packets and kind of forward it in whatever, that is why they are called transparent switches, because you're not directing it to them. But switches do have a MAC address. That is more for, switches will have a MAC address as well as an IP address. That is more for you to, for network management, for you to log into the switch, set its parameters, so on and so forth, where the destination is specifically the switch. But if you are sending a packet, switches are transparent. They are not going to do anything to your packet. They'll just follow.
I want to ask that how to configure that proxy ARP. In case we don't have direct communication with the destination, we can't ask what is the MAC address. So means by textbook, we just tell the students that we can configure a proxy ARP, but exactly where it has been configured? Is it configured in gateway or router or in any server?
So conceptually, any machine which is part of the same subnet, you can configure it as a proxy ARP. What it is basically doing is it is acting on behalf of some other machine where it says, if host A wants to find out what the IP address, MAC address of host C is, but host C is not within the particular subnet. Now what you do is host B, you delegate it saying that when someone asks for whatever host C, you pass on your MAC address so that you get the packets corresponding to host C to B. Then B's responsibility is to pass it to the other. You can configure it on your actual host itself.
So is it like configuring an access control list in one system for all the other systems?
Access control, no, there is a setup for it. I mean, I have not done proxy ARP setup myself, but there are certain commands you have to execute. So a regular desktop can also be converted such that you can convert it into. It need not be, anything, most routers also provide that functionality. Most switches also provide that functionality. Even a desktop provides that functionality. So there are a set of commands which you use to convert it. What is the exact command sequence? I don't know. But just Google it, you will know.
So is it through hyperterminal we do the configuration?
No, it's just like, for example, BRCTL is a bridge command. Just like that, there will be a command to do this also. But as I said, I don't know in Windows. In Linux, there will be a bunch of commands you have to execute to convert the thing. So it's just a bunch of commands. There is nothing else more sophisticated. What is the set of commands? I don't know offhand.
Thank you.
Yesterday, while doing the last question, fourth question, the SSHs, we are trying to analyze the packet in the WireShark. So initially, we got the ARP request packet, but we are waiting for the ARP response packet. Initially, we thought maybe the number of packets that we had actually dumped was very less, 40 packets. Mm. Then I tried to see the cache table in the local machine, and the cache table is maintaining the MAC address already of the next machine that I'm doing SSH. So maybe I thought that is why I'm not getting the response. So I again cleared the cache table. Again, I rerun for quite a few minutes. Still, it's interesting. I don't know. It should not be an anomaly of such form, but I had seen that the ARP request packet I get, but the ARP response packet still I do not get.
Who is generating this ARP request?
Initially, I started a fresh connection with another machine, so I can see the ARP request being pushed into the next machine, the broadcast. Yes,
okay.
I can see that. Problem, we had observed for, we had run the practical many times, thinking maybe something is wrong, but till the end, we end up getting the connection, but we don't find the ARP response packet. Request packet, we can see the details, ARP request packet. We could not end up finding the ARP response packet.
But it's probably there already as part of the ARP cache.
No, that is what we had seen. It is already maintained in the cache. We deleted the cache. We verified.
But
that
you,
is
you are using your own laptop to do something.
No, no. We had seen in the services file, so we cleared the cache. We see we had observed the cache table. Initially, it maintained the MAC address. We verified. Cross-counter checking.
So whatever it is, the specific thing, unless I see what is happening, I mean, it's not something where you tell and, I mean, I have to sit with you, you need to show
definitely,
me the trace,
definitely, because
whatever. So
it's just surprising that ARP request packet I could get actually, but without getting seeing the response packet, we could establish a connection. It should not happen that way.
Sure.
Cannot happen.
You show me in the lab and I'll have a look. But that said, all kind of weird things start to happen in the lab. That's the regular norm. Like you expect something, but something else happens. It could be due to misconfiguration. It could be to many other reasons. One has to kind of figure out what it is.
What is the difference between destination, host, unreachable, and request timeout? Two types of error occur when we try to ping some host. So I saw that two types of error occurs, destination host unreachable and request timeout.
Okay, so destination, so again, depends upon if you're talking about it appearing on the terminal, right? The timeout is something which may be being printed locally. It waited for the response to come within this time. It timed out, it did not get. So it's a software mechanism where like you put like printf with some time exceeded, print that the timeout has happened. So that is the printout mechanism. But why did a timeout happen? The reason for that is that the destination host is unreachable. So that the fact that you determine destination host unreachable is could be that there was some intermediate router who sent an ICMP message that said that ICMP code type is that, and thereby you're using it to specify it.
So means destination host unreachable message is generated by ICMP packet.
Yes, there is an
interfacing of that router that this network is not available.
Yes,
host is not it.
Yeah, it's not necessary that all routers will generate it. In case the router does not generate it, also if you are not getting a response, you will conclude that the destination host is unreachable. It's a coding artifact. I mean, it depends on how you coded it.
And suppose that if we don't have any router, we are having one local area connection. And if you are pinging some host within the network, and suppose that this IP address is not available on that particular switch, then the error will generate that request timeout only.
Yes, precisely. Yeah.
There is no any kind of error destination host unreachable.
Yeah. That is because, as I said, it's probably derived from the ICMP. Someone has given an ICMP error message that specified that the destination host is unreachable. Typically, routers do that.
Thank you.
Ma'am, one question from my side is that whenever we used to type a ping command, at the end of the reply, a field shows a TTL. A TTL usually show 128, 127, even 126 also, 64 also, 32 also. So you make me correct if my answer is right. That is the field which shows the number of the hops covered. Is that right?
No. TTL field is saying what is the lifetime of this particular packet. In other words, if any router were to receive this packet and the time to live field has expired, it can drop the packet. Now the TTL, even though it says time to live, it's basically a hop count. Let's view it as a hop count. If I set my TTL to be 64, all it is telling is this packet can hop 64 hops. After that, its lifetime has expired, you drop it. That is what TTL means. So TTL, whatever value, when you set TTL in your packet to be 64, you're telling to the internet that let my packet hop for 64, after that you drop it because it's past the expiry.
Ma'am, sometimes it shows 128, sometimes it shows 127.
Yeah, it is.
Why that kind of variation?
So see, many of these things, TTL fields are set by different, I mean, in ping implementation, I mean, depends upon, is it the same ping implementation that is showing a TTL field of different values, which I seriously doubt. But from one to the other, like one ping may generate a TTL of X, but if you're using something else, trace root or whatever, it will have some other TTL. Whatever I'm saying, it's whoever is coding, whatever is the default value they have set, that is what will be in the TTL. So if you as a coder, you set one value, I as a coder set as another value, things will be different. there is no standard TTL that people have to employ. People are free to put whatever TTL they want. Typically, it will be in excess of 64.
In a local area network, having the star topology with unmanageable switch, if a sender is sending message to the some destination, whether it will employ the broadcasting or the unicasting?
Well, it depends upon what the switch has within its table, switching table.
It is an unmanageable switch of any configuration or any organization.
No, it depends on, that is what, these are called learning bridges for a reason. They are learning switches. So if it is a hub, which is not a switch, it will just broadcast.
Okay.
But if it is a switch, switches learn. So most switches of any company, whatever it is, the functionality of the switch is that they have to learn. So what they do is whenever they receive packets, they make note of this packet has come with the source MAC address. It has come on this interface. Thereby, that source will be on that interface.
Means it will be unicasting only in today times.
I would call it forwarding. It came on one link. If it knows that the other endpoint is in this direction, it will only forward on that interface and not on others. So this is the learning capability of switches. I have covered it in as part of the video. So these are called learning bridges, learning switches.
Okay.
But if it doesn't know, it doesn't have it, then it will broadcast. So it's a behavior depending on whether or not it has.
Because whatever switches we are using today in our colleges, to make a local area network.
Yeah.
I want
everything
to know just point that point of view.
Yeah. So it can be broadcast or unicast, as you put it, based on whether or not it learned about that entry or not. Learning is a function of who is sending traffic. So it's not like an automated learning. Only if that other guy sends the traffic, it can learn. If it learned, it'll send it in a more efficient fashion.
So if it learned, it will not broadcast.
Yeah, if it learned, it won't broadcast.
Okay. Thank you.
Ma'am, my question is regarding the switching only. So we say the switch create the table, right? Switching table. So they create the table only when a request is sent.
Any traffic passes through it.
Passes through it. So why don't we use the gratuitous mode?
You do.
Whenever the nodes are connected, they should propagate their MAC address and the table should form.
That is the purpose of one of the purposes of gratuitous ARP. So when you are booted up, right? You send one gratuitous ARP so that the switch will know that you are on that particular interface, so that it makes efficient switching. So that's one of the purposes of gratuitous.
So gratuitous ARP is working on the switches.
No,
so
gratuitous ARP, the host is sending. A host, once it boots up, is sending a gratuitous ARP telling everyone, see, this is my IP address, this is my MAC address. Now this packet, because it's coming for the first time, will probably get flooded across all the switches, but as each of the switches that is there interconnected will note that this MAC address is in this direction, and they'll make an entry of it in their learning table. So next time some packet comes for it, it knows in which interface it should send rather than flood again.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's one of the purposes of gratuitous. The IP duplicate IP detection also is one of the other purposes. So there are many purposes of gratuitous ARPs.
One more question regarding the TCP dump. Yesterday we worked with the command TCP dump, then we took up the traces, then we imported that thing into the Wireshark. So doesn't the Wireshark have a utility where we can capture the live traffic?
Yes, it does. So you can do that also, but again, this is a personal preference. You are comfortable with it. So what I like about TCP dump is the command line use of filters. In Wireshark, it's not like you run the trace and the filtering, maybe as someone who is very familiar with Wireshark and use whatever filters, I find their filters a little bit tedious to configure. So TCP dump, what I like about it is it's just a command line thing. You specify all the filters, you dump it into a file. But I like the GUI aspect of Wireshark, where you can pop up, you can examine everything. TCP dump also, you don't need Wireshark to evaluate. You can read the trace file on using TCP dump itself, but it's not a user-friendly reading of the thing. So I guess the high level point is you can do whatever you're doing with TCP dump alone. You can do whatever you're doing with Wireshark alone. The reason I use a combination is I like TCP dump's filter features to quickly. Wireshark also provides filters. I'm not denying that. It's just convenient for me to type in at a command line whatever filters I want, capture the trace, and then use the GUI capability of Wireshark to evaluate it. It's a personal preference. which many people like who work in networks have this preference. I thought there's a reason for why many people like it, so I imposed it on you also, but you are free to do whatever works for you.
We heard of something called layer 3 switches called MPLS switches. Is it these switches operate on multi-frequency bands for every flow that goes through the switch?
You're talking about MPLS.
Layer 3 switches, right?
Layer 3 switches. Layer 3 switches are kind of like either routers or some of this MPLS.
Yeah, we call MPLS multi-protocol level switching concept. Is it these switches use different frequency bands for every flow that goes through the switch?
Different.
I'm talking about parallel processing. Different frequency bands means signals goes through in different frequency bands.
By frequency band, you're talking about the link layer, the physical...
Inside the switch I'm talking about. For example, a port A on the one side, incoming port
what
A.
What do you mean by frequency at a switch? I did not understand.
This is multiple signals. We can send two data flows at the same time, parallelly. For example, collision to avoid collision. For example, in case of a local area network in a segment, if a bridge transfers in a packet in a frame, no other packets can be transferred.
I think some of the things you're talking about is about the switching. Again, I don't have much experience with them, but there are these cut-through switches and combining with optical something where what they do is whatever comes, you kind of switch it. And the optical links have this very huge bandwidth, the spectrum kind of a thing. So when you cut, you kind of cut it and send it on the switching. So basically you're avoid. So all this is, so router typically in the internet is like where you have to evaluate the header, whatever, and you are always trying to increase or decrease the processing delay at a router. So some of the switch architectures are designed especially in conjunction with the optical fiber to avoid some of these things. So you do kind of, when you get a thing, this is that switching that is being done where you switch from this to the outgoing. Outgoing link is defined by a frequency band. So whatever comes, that has to go on that frequency band. So you do that conversion and push it forward. So that is dependent on the switch architecture. Yes, there are switches like that. Okay, so lab, I think, I'm happy to take more questions you have with respect to the lab.
Mm-hmm.